The role of students, women, Muslims, and the masses. A prominent part of the Swadeshi agitation was played by the students of Bengal. They practiced and propagated Swadeshi and took the lead in organizing picketing shops selling foreign cloth. The government made every attempt to suppress the students. Orders were issued to penalize those students and colleges whose students took an active part in the Swadeshi agitation. Their grants in aid and other privileges were to be withdrawn. They were to be disaffiliated. Their students were not to be permitted to compete for scholarships and were to be barred from all service under the government. Disciplinary action was taken against the students found guilty of the participating in the national agitation. Many of them were fined, expelled from the schools and colleges, arrested and sometimes beaten by the police with lathis. The students, however, refused to be cowed down. A remarkable aspect of the Swadeshi agitation was the active participation of women in the movement. The traditionally home-centered women of the urban middle classes joined processions and picketing. From then on, they were able to take an active part in the nationalist movement. Many prominent Muslims joined the Swadeshi movement, including Abdul Rasool, the famous barrister, Likayat Hussain, the popular agitator, and the Ghaznavi, the businessman. Maulana Abul Kalam Azad joined one of the revolutionary terrorist groups. Many other middle and upper class Muslims, however, remained neutral or led by the Nawab of Dhaka, who was given a loan of rupees 14 lakhs by the government of India. Even supported partition on the plea that East Bengal would have a Muslim majority. In this communal attitude, the Nawab of Dhaka and others were encouraged by the officials. In a speech at Dhaka, Lord Curzon declared that one of the reasons for partition was to invest the Mohammedans in Eastern Bengal with a unity with which they have not yet enjoyed since the days of old Musalman, Viceroys and Kings. All India aspect of the movement. The cry for Swadeshi and Swaraj was soon taken up by other provinces of India. Movements in support of Bengal's unity and boycott of foreign goods were organized in Bombay, Madras and Northern India. The leading role in spreading the Swadeshi movement to the rest of the country was played by Tilak. Tilak quickly saw that with the inauguration of this movement in Bengal, a new chapter in the history of nationalism had opened. Here was a challenge and an opportunity to lead a popular struggle against the British Raj and to unite the entire country in one bond of common sympathy. The growth of militancy. The leadership of the anti-partition movement soon passed to the militant nationalists like Tilak, Bipin Chandra Pal and Aurobindo Ghosh. This was due to many factors. Firstly, the early movement of the protest led by moderates failed to yield results. Even the Liberal Secretary of the State, John Morley, from whom much was expected by the moderate nationalists, declared the partition to be a settled fact which would not be changed. Secondly, the government of the two Bengals, particularly the of East Bengal, made active efforts to divide Hindus and Muslims. Seeds of Hindu-Muslim disunity in Bengal politics were perhaps sown at this time. This embittered the nationalists, but most of all, it was the repressive policy of the government which led people to militant and revolutionary politics. The government of East Bengal in particular tried to crush the nationalist movement. Official attempts at preventing student participation in the Swadeshi agitation have already been mentioned above. The singing of Bande Mataram in the public streets in East Bengal was banned. Public meetings were restricted and sometimes forbidden. Laws controlling the press were enacted. Swadeshi workers were prosecuted and imprisoned for long periods. Many students were awarded even corporal punishment. From 1906 to 1909, more than 550 political cases came up from Bengal courts. Prosecutions against large number of nationalist newspapers were launched. And freedom of press was completely suppressed. Military police was stationed in many towns where it clashed with the people. One of the most notorious examples of repression was a police assault on the peaceful delegates of the Bengal Provisional Conference at Barisal in April 1906. Many of the young volunteers were severely beaten up and the conference itself was forcibly dispersed. In December 1908, nine Bengal leaders, including the venerable Krishna Kumar Mitra and Ashwini Kumar Dutt, were deported. Earlier in 1907, Lala Lajpat Rai and Ajit Singh had been deported following riots in the canal colonies of Punjab. In 1908, the great Tilak was again arrested and given the savage sentence of 6 years imprisonment. Chidambaram Pillai in Madras and Hari Sarvottam Rao and others in Andhra were put behind bars. As the militant nationalists came to the fore, they gave the call for passive resistance in addition to Swadeshi and boycott. They asked the people to refuse to cooperate with the government and to boycott government service. The courts, governments, schools, the colleges and the municipalities and legislative councils, and thus, as Aurobindo Ghosh put it, to make the administration under present conditions impossible, the militant nationalists tried to transform the Swadeshi and anti-partition agitation into a mass movement and gave the slogan of independence from foreign rule. Aurobindo Ghosh openly declared, "Political freedom is the labyrinth of the nation." Thus, the question of the partition of Bengal became a secondary one, and the question for India's freedom became the central question of Indian politics. The militant nationalists also gave the call of self-sacrifice without no great aim could be achieved. It should be remembered, however, that the militant nationalists also failed giving a positive lead to the people. They were not able to give effective leadership or to create an effective organization to guide their movement. They aroused the people but did not know how to harness or utilize the newly released energies of the people or to find new forms of political struggle. Passive resistance and non-cooperation remained mere ideas. They also failed to reach to the real masses of the country. The peasants, their movement remained confined to the urban lower and the middle classes and zamindars. They had come to a political dead end by the beginning of 1908. Consequently, the government succeeded to a large extent in suppressing them. Their movement could not survive the arrest of their main leader, Tilak, and the retirement from active politics of Bipin Chandra Pal and Aurobindo Ghosh. But the upsurge of the nationalist sentiments could not die. People had been aroused from their slumber of centuries. They had learned to take a bold and fearless attitude in politics. They had acquired self-confidence and self-reliance and learned to participate in new forms of mass mobilization and political action. They now waited for a new movement to arise. Moreover, they were able to learn valuable lessons from their experience. Gandhiji wrote later that after the partition, people saw that petitions must be backed by force and that they must be capable of suffering. The anti-partition agitation, in fact, marked a great revolutionary leap forward for Indian nationalism. The later national movement was to draw heavily on its legacy. Thank you everyone for tuning in. We will start with the growth of revolutionary nationalism in the next recording. Thank you everyone for tuning in and all the best for your exams. Do share and subscribe the channel as well. Thank you.